साक्षी थे।
चेयरमैन, I've been listening attentively to the debate so far, and I have to say, for me, this is not a theoretical matter or a second-hand issue. I was there when the cyclone started. I was in Thiruvananthapuram the night of the 29th and 30th. I actually went out to the coastal area in the morning of the 30th. There were extremely heavy rains and howling winds. In fact, we were expecting the next day the visit of our party leader Rahul Gandhiji. And I remember filming on my phone the posters and hoardings that had been put up for him fluttering, flying about in the breeze, and the tent that had been constructed for him for his function was already being ripped apart by the winds. I said, this function is not going to happen. This is going to get worse. Having seen it from that point, I can assure you that what developed after that was a matter of intense personal concern, because over the next few days, I had the mortification not just of watching it unfold and helping with some of the coordination of the response, including calling Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman at home and pulling her out. She was extremely helpful and responsive, calling the Coast Guard officials myself. Apart from all of that, there is also the fact that I then had to go to the homes of those who were bereaved, either who had lost people certainly or whose people were missing, whose loved ones were missing. And there is really something terribly sobering. You go to village after village, there is a billboard with the photographs and names of the people missing, very often young people, teenagers in some cases, husbands, fathers, brothers. I have gone to a makeshift shrine where four women were awaiting news of the return of their loved ones, and I lit agarbattis and prayed with them. I went to homes of people in which both children, in some cases, both brothers had gone. There were cases in which one brother had come back and another had disappeared under the waves. The pain that people have suffered. I remember walking into a church in Vizhinjam where every inch was occupied by the families of wailing women waiting for news of their loved ones. Some had lost a father, some had lost their brothers and sons. Some were in complete despair. They had no place to go because their homes had also been shattered by the howling gusts of wind. This is a major national calamity, and I urge the government to recognize it for what it is. Frankly, in this part of the country, hardly anyone paid attention because the Gujarat elections were on. That's what the media was focused on. But the lives of hundreds of people have been affected. In Kerala, 77 are certain confirmed killed, still over 100 missing, almost certainly not likely to come back. In Tamil Nadu, the numbers, particularly from Kanyakumari, are also high. We have had lots of boats missing. And boat is not just a boat. It's not like losing a car. It is a means of livelihood for poor people who have nothing else. And then, of course, you have the houses that have been damaged as well, and the psychological trauma of waiting for news of their loved ones. This is really a horrendous human tragedy that we in Parliament must truly grasp and understand the nature of. I would like to say with deep respect to the Home Minister, who is here for us today, that there is no substitute for a serious inquiry into what happened. I have had the privilege of calling on the Prime Minister, both alone and subsequently with Kerala MPs. When I met him alone, I did say that it was extremely important that an inquiry be conducted so we know exactly what happened. To take the debate that we had a little earlier today on the warning issues. Both sides were, as you know, shouting at each other here, and I don't want to enter into that. What I do want to say is that I have looked into this in some detail. I have the Indian Meteorological Department's official cyclone warning document, the standard operating procedures of the Indian Meteorological Department. According to that, there are four stages. There is a pre-cyclone watch, which would be for early potential disturbances. There is a cyclone alert, which is supposed to be 48 hours before a cyclone. There is a cyclone warning 24 hours before, and then a post-landfall outlook until the disturbances subside. Now, what have we got here? I have looked at the actual bulletins received in Kerala, and I can tell you that there is only reference to a depression and a deep depression. I have actually got the exact wording. I don't want to waste the time of this House. Wait, I've got the exact thing, and I've conveyed this also to the Prime Minister. At 11:50 a.m. on the 29th, there's depression over southwest Bay, Bengal, off Sri Lanka coast. 30th at 5:30. It says deep depression over the Comoran area, that is Kanyakumari area and neighborhood. At 8:30 on 30th, it still says deep depression over Comoran area and cyclone alert for Lakshadweep Islands. And it is only at 12 noon on 30th that it says cyclonic storm Oki. No, but by the time not only the cyclone hit, people had gone out to sea as late as the previous night. The sad thing is, maybe those who had gone out 2-3 days earlier could not have been saved. But people went out literally until such time as the cyclone hit. And to my mind, there is something to be looked at in how we allowed this to happen. How could human lives, precious human lives, have been lost because we couldn't get a simple warning right? The question of blame game between the IMD and the state meteorological department, I leave them to sort out. But I think the government, the central government, as a neutral player in this, should definitely conduct an inquiry into this issue. But this is not the only issue. There is very seriously the question of the protocols and the equipment for search and rescue. When I say protocols, there is simply some concern, and I'm basing myself, I don't claim to be objective or neutral, I'm basing myself on the complaints of the fisher people and the people in the fishing villages who've spoken to me. They say, for example, that on the 29th night, when they first got distress flares from some of their fishermen, that the Coast Guard were unwilling to go out. They also claim, and the Coast Guard may not confirm this, but we need to know what the truth was. They also claim that when the Coast Guard did go out on the 30th, they could find nobody. In fact, I believe in the entire day, they only found one person. That was unacceptable when there were hundreds of people out in peril at that time. They also pointed out that when the Navy got involved, and I'm very pleased that the Defense Ministry responded as soon as an appeal was made to them, and the Navy got involved. Nonetheless, the Navy, they say, didn't know where to look. The Coast Guard has a territorial limit of 12 nautical miles. They can't go beyond that. The Navy can go much farther, in fact, as far as they wish. But they didn't know where to look, and according to the fisher people, for 4 days, no one agreed to take the local people on board the ships to actually find them. When the Navy went out, one of the people who went on board a Navy ship told me that they found a body floating, but the Navy said, we cannot take this body because we have no facilities to keep the body on the boat. We have no mobile ice boxes. We have no deep freeze facilities. We cannot take the body. And this was a horrifying thing to the fisher people when families are waiting desperately for news of what happened to their loved ones. I immediately called the defense minister from the village as soon as this news reached me. The Navy issued a statement saying that they have not refused to pick up anybody, but they all in the same statement, they said that they are still in the process of acquiring mobile mortuaries. I think one can draw a very clear inference. They didn't have it, and this fisherman had no reason to lie to me. So these are very serious issues that also need to be the subject of a serious inquiry. A third question is about infrastructure. This also needs to be looked at. Saugata Roy Sahab very rightly mentioned the Vikram Sarabhai Space Center and the satellites. But it's not just the question of the satellites. The central government has spent 20 crore rupees on a Doppler radar system that is supposed to warn about cyclones. What happened? Did it work? Did it not work? If it worked, where did the information go? Who is responsible for neglecting the information? I think there my honorable friend Saugata Roy is totally correct. He is saying that how can we be in Kerala, which is where Vikram Sarabhai Space Center is based, and that too is based in Tumba in the Trivandrum district, in Thiruvananthapuram itself, in my constituency, and yet the information did not reach the people whose lives therefore could not be saved. That too needs to be looked at, and I hope that the investigation will cover this. Also, are our existing protocols adequate? What about the joint typhoon warning center that was set up in the US for international typhoons? Can we participate? Are there financial issues preventing us? We are being increasingly subject to weather disturbances. Let's face it, global warming is making weather all the more unpredictable. It has been pointed out by an earlier speaker that normally typhoons are on the eastern side. They're in the Bay of Bengal, not on the Arabian Sea side. Today we have seen a cyclone come right from off southwest Sri Lanka, past Kanyakumari to Trivandrum and to Lakshadweep. This is news. For this we must be prepared, and if it means more expenditure, please let us do this. And the fourth aspect of the inquiry is deployment. Where are we deploying our search and rescue vessel capacity? I'm sorry to say that there's very little in Thiruvananthapuram, which is clearly now twice the very, very serious area. The the search and rescue aircraft and vessels that exist are actually in Kochi. And the truth is that that means we're losing half an hour to 1 hour each time, even by air, if we have to do any serious search and rescue. I've also conveyed both to the Defence Minister and the Prime Minister a suggestion that we should create 5 minutes. So there is nobody in this house who is more affected than me. My constituency is the most affected, sir. Please give me 5 minutes. 75 people from my constituency. 77 is today's news. It's terrible, sir. So I've suggested to the Prime Minister and to the Defence Minister that we should set up in our country the marine equivalent of the territorial army. We have a territorial army. If one day, God forbid, there is a serious war, we'll be pressing the territorial army into service. Why can't we do this at the level of the Coast Guard for our fisher people? Hire from the fishing communities people who understand the sea, people who understand the problems, they understand where the fisher people are going. Give them 1 month's training, recruit them. Thereafter, they go back to their normal profession. And then, perhaps, whenever there is a natural calamity, a search and rescue matter, you can bring them on board and get them to go. If the reason why the Coast Guard and the Navy initially did not accept these people is because they would feel they're not professionally trained, then my suggestion, Mr. Home Minister, would actually respond to this need, because you would be able to train them, and as trained people, they will be able to go on these naval ships and guide them to rescuing lives. This is my humble request to the government. I finally want to end on the issue that everybody has already spoken about, because I realize there's not much new to be said, and that is the question of compensation. The fact is that when the finance minister answered this yesterday during the demand of the supplementary demands for grants, where I suggested there should be a supplementary demand for a serious compensation package, he only referred to the existing national disaster funds that are administered by your ministry. Now, you know, sir, that that is not adequate. The entire Prime Minister's Relief Fund is only 153 crores, whereas for this crisis alone, we have got from the Kerala government a request for 7,348 crores. From the Tamil Nadu government, I believe the request is about 9,000 crores. And frankly, it needs, if necessary, a separate appropriation to deal with this calamity. Let me stress, it's not just compensating those who have lost their lives, those who have been injured. There you can give 25 lakhs, as the Kerala government is giving, or 5 lakhs to the injured. You can add some money to rebuild houses, but this is not enough. We need some structural steps to be taken so that the money that we are asking for from the central government can be used constructively. My colleague has mentioned groins and what is called pulimutta, seawalls that will break the force of the water. That's one thing certainly on which resources have not adequately been devoted. I can assure you, because I go up and down my coastal areas, that we do not have enough of these. And in fact, whatever building occurred many years ago, and there has not been resources available. But I would go beyond that, sir. I would say to you that your team should go at the earliest and look not only at immediate needs prompted by the disaster, but also at medium-term and long-term needs. Amongst the medium-term needs, I would stress very much the necessary infrastructure that I have just mentioned. But equally, in the longer term needs, I would like you to ask the question. This is a time when we have to think in a visionary way. Can we live in a society in which the children of fishermen are condemned to only being fishermen? Can we not give them serious vocational training and skill development so that many of them can move away from this profession? I would say, sir, that both agriculture and fishing are now in a position where more people are trying to live from these professions than the professions are able to sustain. This is a very serious challenge facing our country. If we approach it with vision, we have to say we don't need so many people in the farms, we don't need so many people out at sea. And the desperation, do you know how far people, as an MP, I have had cases of my fishermen's boats being arrested in Diego Garcia by the British. They have gone that far because they can't get any adequate fish in the waters closer to India. We have overfished these waters. And so the livelihoods are serious, and I believe that we should take the opportunity of this disaster to approach the matter with vision and conviction and come up with a solution that will give us a long-term solution to the problems of the entire fishing community. With this, sir, I do want to add one final word of appreciation. I do realize that when we in Parliament seem to be critical because the criticisms are coming to us, that we are also perhaps coming across as ungrateful. I want to place and record our gratitude to all the men and women of the Coast Guard and the Navy. I have spoken to some of them. They've done as much as they could, I'm sure, and with the best heart. I don't want anyone to think that we are ungrateful or that the fishing community is ungrateful. And I appreciate, as I said earlier, the responsiveness of the central government. I spoke to Nirmala Ji on the 30th. By the 4th of December, she was there personally. The Prime Minister has been there a couple of days ago. This is good, and we appreciate the fact that the central government is giving this issue importance. We will not say the importance it deserves, because for us there it deserves even more and more urgent importance, but some importance, and I'd be very grateful if, in addition to this gratitude, the long-term outcomes reflect your commitment to resolving this. Thank you, Mr. Minister.